الحمد لله خالق الوجود من العدم وجاعل النور من الظلم ومخرج الصبر من الألم وملقي التوبة على الندم فنشكره على المصائب كما نشكره على النعم ونصلي على رسوله الأكرم ذي الشرف الأشم والنور الأتم والكتاب المحكم وكمال النبيين والخاتم سيد ولد آدم الذي بشر به عيسى ابن مريم ودعا لبعثته إبراهيم عليه السلام حين كان يرفع قواعد بيت الله المحرم فصلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى أتباعه خير الأمم الذين بارك الله بهم كافة الناس العرب منهم والعجم. فالحمد لله الذي أنزل على عبده الكتاب ولم يجعل له عوجا، والحمد لله الذي لم يتخذ ولدا ولم يكن له شريك في الملك ولم يكن له ولي من الذل وكبره تكبيرا، والحمد لله الذي نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن محمدًا عبد الله ورسوله أرسله الله تعالى بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله، وكفى بالله شهيدا. فصلى الله عليه وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا. ثم أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وإن شر الأمور محدثاتها، وإن كل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. يقول سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم بعد أن أقول أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم: بل الإنسان على نفسه بصيرة ولو ألقى معاذيره. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. واللهم ثبتنا عند الموت بلا إله إلا الله، واللهم اجعلنا من الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر، أمين يا رب العالمين. In today's brief khutbah, inshallah ta'ala, I'll admit that before coming here, I was extremely perplexed. Many of you don't know, and some of you do, I'm visiting here from the United States. And I give khutbah pretty much every week all over the country in the United States. But this is the first time I've had the opportunity to speak and give a khutbah in particular. I feel very honored to give a khutbah in the Muslim world. This is the first time I'm actually speaking in the Muslim world, as particularly on the auspicious and honorable occasion of the khutbah. It's a big responsibility. And I've been thinking a lot about what message I can share with you in these few minutes that I have with you. But I've decided to and realized something, that really the message that Muslims need, no matter where they are in the world, is the same. And that's part of the beauty of Islam, is that the reminder, the advice, the counsel that you need and that I need, it doesn't differ from where we come from in the world. And that's what makes our religion one. It makes it universally relevant. So I want to share something with you. I realize there are people in the audience that are far more knowledgeable than I will ever be, and there are people in the audience that may not know a lot. It's also possible that you're sitting in the audience. So I want to give you something in these few minutes, inshallah ta'ala, that's a reminder first and foremost for myself. I want to be able to benefit myself as I speak. But I also want to be able to benefit every last one of you that is here. And obviously, this beautiful occasion of Jumu'ah, Allah Azza wa Jal describes it in the Qur'an, and He says, فَسْعَوْا إِلَىٰ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. Rush to the remembrance of Allah. In other words, remembrance, the idea of remembering something is that you don't get new information. You're told something you already knew, but it's reinforced. So our deen teaches us that even if you're not learning something new, even if you're told something from before, that you're reminded of it, it is still beneficial. It still benefits you. And that's actually even true in psychology. There's a student who has to take an exam. Maybe his exam is on Monday, but on Sunday he's playing video games. So his friend comes and tells him, man, you have an exam. And he goes, I know, but thanks for the reminder. And he stops playing the game and he starts studying for his exam. He knew there's an exam, but the reminder helped him anyway. فَذَكِّرْ فَإِنَّ فَعَتِ الذِّكْرَ فَإِنَّ الذِّكْرَ تَنْفَعُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Reminder benefits believers. So the reminder I wanted to share with you, or some things from it, is the reminder that all of us give ourselves every time we make salah. I want to talk to you about a few reminders from the beginning of Suratul Fatiha. Just a few reminders for myself and all of you. Because obviously if we don't have a relationship with this surah, then we can't possibly have a relationship with the Qur'an. And there's a reason Allah put this surah in the beginning of the Qur'an. It's Allah's way of introducing Himself to us. The first three ayat of this surah, depending on which opinion you go with, I'll just share the opinion that Alhamdulillah is the first ayah, even though there's another legitimate opinion. But Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, and Maliki Yawmiddin. These three ayat are Allah comprehensively introducing Himself. This is Allah introducing Himself to all of humanity. If a non-Muslim, I live in Texas, if a non-Muslim came to me and said, tell me about your Allah, who is this Allah of yours? What can you tell me about Him? I would explain the first three ayat of Surah Al-Fatiha. Why? Because if I try to introduce Allah to Him in my way, I don't know what kind of job I will do, but Allah decided that all of humanity should be introduced to Him with these words. They should get to know Him through these words. And they begin with Alhamdulillah. And Subhanallah, Walhamdulillah, we are the people of Alhamdulillah. What does Alhamdulillah mean? It's basically, even though we can talk about it for hours, just a brief explanation, it is two things. Alhamdulillah is two things. One part of it is that you thank Allah. Thanks is for Allah. The second part of it is appreciation. Appreciation, praise is for Allah. Two things, thanks and praise. They're two separate things. Al-madh wa thana on the one hand, al-shukr on the other hand. They're two different things. Now let's first understand the difference between these two things. You can see a beautiful building and you will praise it, but you will not thank it. You will see an amazing athlete. He plays football. And he scored an amazing goal. You will praise the athlete, but you will not thank the athlete. You'll see a beautiful car, you'll praise the car, but you won't thank the car. And sometimes the opposite is the case. There are some people you have to thank, even though you will never praise them. That happens too. Allah Azza wa Jal, for example, describes that the Muslim has to be grateful to his parents no matter what. Even if your parents are mushrik, you have to be grateful to your parents. أَنِشْكُرْ لِي وَلِوَالِدَيْكَ وَإِنْ جَاهَدَاكَ عَلَىٰ أَن تُشْرِكَ بِمَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٍ. Even if they're struggling against you to do shirk, they want you to leave your iman, and you still have to be grateful to them. You will not praise their shirk, but you will still thank them. So sometimes in life you can have praise without thanks. And sometimes in life you can have thanks without praise. I'll give you another example of thanks without praise so it becomes clear. You have the case of Fir'aun, la'anahu Allah. He, whether he liked it or not, he raised Musa alayhi salam in his castle. And Musa alayhi salam many years later came back to him. And he actually reminded Musa alayhi salam saying, Alam nurabbika fina walida, wa labithta fina min umrika sinin. Didn't you live many years here? Didn't we raise you as a newborn in this house? He's reminding Musa alayhi salam of his favor. And obviously when someone does you a favor, you owe them thanks. So even Musa alayhi salam acknowledges the favor. And he does thank him. He says, وَتِلْكَ نِعْمَةٌ تَمُنُّهَا عَلَيَّ اعترف. He admitted, yes, that is a favor you did for me. When you admit someone's done you a favor, you're thanking them. He thanked even Fir'aun, even though he will never ever praise him. So you can thank someone without praising them, and you can praise someone without thanking them. When we say Alhamdulillah, then we are saying that we praise Allah for whatever He's doing. Whatever He's doing is awesome, it's great. It couldn't be better, it's perfect. No complaints. And after we praise Him, we are also thanking Him that He did it. There are people sitting outside today. The air conditioning in the hall is not enough for you. Yeah, man, it's so hot. And the first thing that should come in your mind as a Muslim is Alhamdulillah, it's hot. Alhamdulillah. You know what that means? Thank Allah, it's hot. And I praise Allah, it's hot. It's a different way of thinking. It's not like anybody else. There are other people who believe in God. Believe me, I know. I meet people of all religions. There are other people who believe in God, but what they don't have, the first thing they don't have is Alhamdulillah. And some Muslims, they don't understand Alhamdulillah. So sometimes they're like, man, I don't get paid enough. But whatever, Alhamdulillah. You're not really saying Alhamdulillah. You're complaining, saying Alhamdulillah. Hey, how's it going with your family? Alhamdulillah. That's not Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah, from the bottom of your heart, you're grateful. For all the things that are going wrong, you're finding there's so many things that are right. If you're feeling hot, at least you're not feeling sick. There are so many other things that could be wrong with you. You know, if your car has a transmission problem, at least it doesn't have a big engine problem. There are so many other things that are going right. We are people of Alhamdulillah. You know what that means? We're constantly grateful, we're constantly positive. If we understood Alhamdulillah, we would never be depressed. The Muslim cannot be depressed. You'll find today in the Ummah, people complain about the state of the Muslims. We complain about, you know, the ignorance of the Muslims, or the corruption within the Muslims. And we complain and we complain and we complain. I tell you, Allah Azza wa Jal is the one who changes our circumstances. All we need to do is turn to Him and say, Alhamdulillah. We have to be positive. We have to be a people of positivity. That's the first thing Allah told us about Himself. What did He tell us next about Himself? He said, Rabbil Alameen. Now the word Rabb, in the English translation of the word, they often use the word Lord. Lord of the worlds. The word Lord is actually pretty inaccurate to describe the word Rabb for many reasons. The English word Lord, you know, I mentioned before, I come from Texas. We are in the southern part of the United States, there are a lot of churches. It's called the Bible Belt. Okay, so there are a lot of huge Christian communities. Every other radio station is a Christian radio station. And they use the word Lord all the time. But when they use the word Lord, they're thinking of Isa alayhi salam, ma'adallah. Right? So the word Lord, because the Christian literature actually has Christian connotations. That's the first problem with it. In America, for example, when somebody uses the word Lord, the first thing that comes in their mind is actually Christianity. That's a problem. The second problem with the word Lord is people don't understand that word anymore. People don't use, it's an old English word, it's not a new English word. The kids that are sitting in the audience here, they don't hear the word Lord. They hear the word Lord and they think, I don't know, Lord of the Rings, where is that from, Lord? They don't understand the word Lord, it's not a common practice word. So what is a closer word? It's actually Master. The word Rabb, the Arab defines it as Al-Malik, Wal-Murabbi, Wal-Mun'im, Wal-Qayyim, Wal-Sayyid. It has a complex definition. But at the essence of the word is Master. Master. And when you think of master, the opposite of master is slave. So if Allah calls Himself master, then He's necessarily calling us slaves. That's what He's doing. The essence, the summary of the entire Quran, my teacher used to say, is if you can understand that Allah is your master, and you can accept that you are His slave, you understand the Quran. And if you cannot accept that, you do not understand the Quran. So let me explain a little bit what that means. What does it mean to be a slave? What does it mean to accept Allah as a master? The difference between a free person and a slave is very simple. A free person does whatever they want. They can eat whatever they want. They can look at whatever they want. But a slave, before he does anything, what does he have to do? He has to ask the master, can I do that? Can I eat this? Can I go there? He has to constantly go and ask the master. A free person gets to do, has all the choices in front of him, but the slave doesn't. If there's a free person and a slave sitting at a table, there's food in front of them, the free person is eating, and the slave is waiting. When the master says, I can eat, I will eat. And the master, I will look at this food, I'll look at the chicken, and then I'll look at the master will say, yeah, you can eat that. Okay, I can eat the chicken. You know, he'll wait. Because you have every choice you make, you will turn back to the master. Allah calls Himself master. And this is also very powerful. For another reason. In the word master and in the word slave, there's a negative connotation. In human history, there has been slavery. And in slavery, people are humiliated. The person who's a slave is humiliated. And they cannot wait to be free. They want to get rid of their master. When you think of, you know, for example, slavery in the United States, for example, the Africans that were enslaved couldn't wait to be free. They fought for their freedom. And they don't have love for their master, they only have hate for their master. They have a resentment towards their master. And sometimes that resentment, even after you become free, there will be centuries that go by, you will still hate the people that enslaved you from before. So when you think of slavery, you don't think of love, you think of hate. You don't think of praise and you don't think of gratitude. You don't think of praising your master, not genuinely. You don't think of thanking your master. You hate them. But you know what? Allah calls Himself Master. But before He called Himself our Master, He told us that all praise belongs to Him and all thanks belongs to Him. No other Master will have Alhamdulillah. There could be other Masters. There could be other Masters and they will have slaves, but their slaves will never thank them and praise them genuinely, like Allah has thanked and He's praised. And there could be other Masters, but the slaves never come to the Master and say, "Hey, I want to be your slave. Can I be your slave, please? Could you put some chains on my hands, please? I'd love that." Nope. Slaves always come by force. They're never willingly coming to slavery. This Master is different. He's not forcing any of you into His slavery. He's saying, "فَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيُؤْمِنْ وَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيَكْفُرْ." Whoever wants to come, they're welcome. Whoever wants to go, go ahead. Whoever wants to disbelieve, it's your choice. What kind of Master is this? He gives the choice to the slaves. And even after He gives the choice, the slave comes back and says, no, I want to be your slave. إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ. We tell him ourselves, "Yeah, we're ready. We're ready to be your slaves. We're ready to worship only you." This is Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Now, this is Allah introducing Himself as a Master. But then He gives what I want to spend the most time on, I know my time is short with you, the most time on I want to spend on this next ayah, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. And I think one of the most difficult challenges in translating the Qur'an is translating ayat like Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. They have an ocean of wisdom in them, and a translator can only use 3 or 4 words to communicate what Allah has said that takes the Mufassir 20 pages. Or the Mufassir might write a book on just Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, and the translator only has one sentence to do that job. So it's impossible. But at least some things you should appreciate about Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. This is a little bit of a difficult subject, so I would ask you to try to pay extra attention, inshaAllah ta'ala, in order to get the benefits from this discussion. The word Ar-Rahman in the Arabic language actually means 3 things. I know they say the most beneficent, the most merciful. I'm sure you've read that translation before. Or the most merciful, the most kind, and other variations of that. But that doesn't really... You don't really understand what the difference between these 2 things is. So let's discuss it in a little more depth. The word Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim have something in common. Both of them, before I tell you the 3 things about Ar-Rahman, both Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim have something in common. They have the word Rahmah in common. The word Rahmah actually does not mean mercy. Mercy is not a good translation of Rahmah either. Because Rahmah includes in it care and love and consideration. The Rahm of a mother... When a woman is pregnant, her womb, her belly is called rahm. And why is it called rahm? Because the baby is taken care of from all the sides. The rent is paid, the food is covered. If there, you know, all the problems, if there is a problem, the mother will have it, the child will not have it. The child is completely taken care of from all angles. And even if the mother is having some trouble, the child won't know. Child will have no idea. Allah Azza wa Jal, when He describes Himself as Ar-Rahim, He's telling us that He has covered us entirely in His love, in His mercy, in His blessing, in His care. He's taking care of you and me all the time. But now let's talk about the word Ar-Rahman in particular. When Allah's love, and Allah's care, and Allah's mercy, and Allah's help is extreme, it's not normal, it's extreme, then you use Rahman. The an at the end, sighatul mubalagha, it's called in Arabic, it's used when something is extreme, it's not normal. It's unusually loving, excessively loving, excessively caring. That's Ar-Rahman, that's the one thing about it. The second thing about it, one, it's extreme. The second, that it's happening right now. You know, you say about somebody, this person is patient. I have a patient friend. Does that mean they're being patient right now? No. That means they have the quality of patience. Maybe they're angry right now, I don't even know. So you can give somebody a quality, but it doesn't mean that that quality is obvious right now. Like if I call somebody generous. I call somebody generous. Does that mean they're spending money right now? No. That doesn't mean that. It just means they have that quality. When we call Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahman, when we call Allah Ar-Rahman, we're not just saying that He's loving, and that He's merciful, and that He's kind, and that He's caring, and He's extreme in doing all of that. We are saying that He's doing all of that when? Right now, He is being Ar-Rahman to me, and He's being Ar-Rahman to you. It is extreme, and it is immediate.
It is extreme and it's happening right now. Now, after this, the third meaning of Ar-Rahman, the three things, it's extreme, it's immediate, and the third one's a little bit scary. The Arabic language has certain patterns. So when someone is thirsty, you can say atshan. Someone's hungry, you can say jawa'an. Someone's angry, you can say ghadban. And someone's extremely loving and merciful, you say rahman, right? It's on this pattern. But this pattern actually means something that is not permanent. It's not permanent. Atshan is thirsty. Is someone thirsty permanently? No. Jawa'an is hungry. Is someone hungry permanently? No. Ghadban is angry. Is somebody angry permanently? Sister, don't raise your hand. I know about your husband. Don't raise your hand. It's okay. It's not permanent. Anger wears off. Ar-Rahman actually means someone, Allah is loving you and He's taking care of you and He's extreme in doing so right now, but don't think that it is permanent. And I'll explain that in a second. But these three things I want you to remember. Extreme, happening right now, and not permanent. Now let's turn to Ar-Rahim. It also has to do with love and care, but it has two qualities. This word has two qualities. Ar-Rahman had three qualities. Ar-Rahim has two qualities. The two qualities of Ar-Rahim are, it is always. It's ism sifa, it's always. That is different from the first word, because the first word was temporary. This one is permanent. And the second of this is, a sifa is an adjective, is something that is not necessarily obvious. It's not necessarily happening right now. Like if I say to you, you are, like I mentioned before, you are patient, or you are funny. That doesn't mean you're telling me a joke right now, you just have a good sense of humor. It's not coming out right now, it's inside you, but it's not outside of you right now. So Ar-Rahim is something that is not active. It's a quality, but it's not active. It's there. So somebody says, my mother is very loving, right? That loving doesn't mean she's always loving. It just means she has that quality. That's what Ar-Rahim means. Now the beauty of these ayat is that if Allah only said Ar-Rahman, if He only said Ar-Rahman, then the mercy of Allah would be extreme, it would be immediate, but it would not be permanent. He said Ar-Rahim immediately after and He made it permanent. If He said only Ar-Rahim, the mercy would not be extreme. Because Ar-Rahim is not extreme, Ar-Rahman is extreme. And it wouldn't be immediate. So He put both of them together. So we know that today, right now, Allah will take care of me, and tomorrow, today Ar-Rahman, tomorrow Ar-Rahim. Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu was asked, what does Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim mean? He said, Ar-Rahman is for the people of this world, and Ar-Rahim is for the Akhirah. It's so powerful, because he understood this world is temporary, and the next world is permanent. So he said, Ar-Rahman is this world, Ar-Rahim is the next world. SubhanAllah. The Sahaba understood the Qur'an, and so immediately they understood these things. And they knew how to process them. But now let's give you a simple example to help you appreciate once more just some things about Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. You know, somebody, let me give you an example. Some of you, you have jobs, and maybe you get paid on Thursday. You're waiting for your paycheck on Thursday. And your boss is in traffic, and I know the traffic in Qatar. So your boss is in traffic, and you gotta go home at 3 o'clock. And it's 2:35, and he's not here. And you need your paycheck, because you gotta pay the rent, you have to pay the electricity bill, you gotta put gas in the car, you know, you got things to do. And you have no money, so you gotta wait for him. So now you're getting worried. And he's not here, 2:35, now it's 2:40, it's 2:45, he's still not here. And your employee, your friend comes and tells you, don't worry, the boss will be here. He's reliable. He has a good quality, he's dependable, he's reliable. You're like, I know he's dependable, brother, but I wish he was being dependable right now. I don't need that quality inside him, I need it to be active right now. Somebody's having a hard time and you tell him, Allah is merciful. I know Allah is merciful. But I need His mercy when? Right now. Allah Azza wa Jal knows when people have a problem, they don't worry about the future, they worry about right now. If you are really hungry, if you come home really hungry, and your wife says to you, and you haven't seen the food yet, you don't even smell it. And your wife says to you, so what do you think we should eat next week? You say, lady, I am dying right, I don't care about next week, feed me right now. I don't care about tomorrow. And then she gives you the food and she takes care of your now, and then you look at her and say, so what do you want to eat next week? Then you worry about tomorrow. When your immediate problem is taken care of, only then you can think about tomorrow. This is the nature of the human being. We want things to be taken care of right now, and the moment our right now is taken care of, we start worrying about the future. If you don't have money to pay the rent, you're worried about that right now. The second you pay the rent, you start worrying about next month. That's your nature. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, I will take care of you right now with Ar-Rahman. And I will take care of your future with Ar-Rahim. Subhanallah. We are wrapped up in the love and the care and the mercy of Allah. But there's a problem. And in these few minutes that I have left with you, I want to share with you this is a big problem. It's a big problem. I see this problem in America, and I'm also seeing it here. I was realistic before I came here. We're a global world now. The problem of Muslim youth in America are the same as the problems of Muslim youth in Qatar, or in Dubai, or in Saudi, or in Pakistan, or in Egypt. The youth have the same problems. You have the problem of some kids saying, some young people saying, and even older people saying, I know it's haram, but Allah is so merciful, man. He's like, Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim. I know it's haram, but come on, Allah's not gonna punish me for that. He's gonna take it easy on me. I wanna help you understand this problem. Because Allah described His love and His mercy with such an extreme way, some people might try to take advantage of it. Some people might say, it's just a little bit of drugs. It's not that much. I just do it like twice a week. And I don't do it on Friday. And I stop all of Ramadan, I stop. I don't drink a single, bottle of liquor in Ramadan. But other than that, sometimes, it's okay. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. I'll make Umrah this year, it'll be fine. They figure out they can just eat haram things, look at haram things, do haram things, and it's okay, Allah will take care of it. Allah will forgive. I want to give you an example to help you understand this. One of my earliest jobs was I used to teach at a school. Young kids. These are 7-year-old kids, second, third grade kids. And I thought that these kids are going to love me. I will tell them stories, I will make jokes with them, I will jump up on the desk and I will jump around and entertain them and I will scare them and all kinds of things. These kids used to love me. I used to go in there and tell jokes and tell stories and they used to be loud. The principal used to come in and say, what's going on here? And I used to say, sorry, we'll calm down. I did this for a whole week with these kids. I used to walk into class and the kids used to clap. But then after a week, I go back into class. And I say, okay guys, open up chapter 5. Nobody opens up chapter 5. They're all looking at me. Tell us a story. Tell us another joke. And kids are talking to each other. There are people jumping around. There's a kid who's got a pencil in his hand and he's writing his name on the wall. And he's looking at me. And he's writing it. And he's looking at me again. And he's writing it. You ever see that happen? And then his friend says, I think he sees you. He says it to him. And he goes, I know, but he's a nice guy. And he keeps going. They think I'm merciful. They think I'm kind. So they figure, hey, this is a nice teacher. We should do whatever we want. When Allah describes His mercy and His love, some slaves of Allah, man, they try to take advantage. Like, Allah is so merciful. No problem. I'll give you one more example before I conclude. I haven't introduced Allah to you yet. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim is 2 ayat. There are 3 ayat that introduce us to Allah. But before I get to the 3rd ayah, I want to give you a simple lesson. Imagine there's a man and he has a slave. So this guy has a slave. And he tells the slave, you can do whatever you want. Here's the field. He owns a field. He said, you can do whatever you want in this field. You can eat whatever you want, go wherever you want. Just don't go on the other side. There's a line. He drew a line with chalk. Not even a fence. It's just chalk. Just don't go on the other side. So the slave is happy. He can do whatever he wants. And one day the slave is close to the border. And he falls. And he falls on the wrong side. And he immediately looks at the master staring at him. And he says, sorry. It was a mistake. And the master doesn't say anything. No problem. He doesn't say anything. So he gets up, he dusts himself off. He's okay. Next day he pretends to fall. And I said, sorry. The master doesn't even get up, doesn't even look angry. He says, this is pretty good. I mean, he told me not to go on the other side, but I've gone twice and I didn't get in trouble. This must mean it's okay. Some Muslim says, I had some haram substances and no lightning struck from the sky. Allah did not send like an axe wielding from the sky, chopping my tongue off when I lied. It should be okay. Allah is okay with it. You know, you try to earn some money the wrong way, you look up at the sky, oh, nothing happened, I'm okay. I could do some more. So this slave starts going on the other side over and over and over again. And a whole year goes by. Now he spends most of his time on the other side. So the master calls him. After 1 year, he calls him. And he says, so how's it going? Pretty good. You're pretty kind. Love it. And he says, listen, remember when I told you you shouldn't go on the other side? He goes, yeah, I remember. Well, I've decided to punish you for that. But I will punish you for I've been counting. Every time you went, and I will punish you for every single time you went, but I will punish you all at the same time. I was holding off. I didn't want to punish you right away, I wanted to punish you eventually. I mean, it was your choice. I didn't stop you from going, I just said don't go, and I told you there will be consequences. But I've decided to get you right now, with all of it. All at the same time, 1 year's worth of transgressions. This is judgment day. The human being thinks you can get away with whatever you're doing. No problem. I did something bad yesterday, nothing bad happened today. I should do it again today. Then I could do it again tomorrow, nothing's gonna happen. It's all good. But Allah Azza wa Jalla says, He puts the picture, He balances the picture, He says, Maliki yawmiddin. He's the owner of the day on which perfect judgment will be executed. Everybody will get exactly what they deserve. He's the master of that day too. So as I leave you in this khutbah, I want to share with you that Allah balanced two things. On the one hand, He is extremely loving, extremely merciful. And on the other hand, if you take advantage of His love and His mercy, then He will judge you too. On judgment day, there are only two kinds of people. People who get judgment, who get accounted, who get audited, that their records are checked, and the people who Allah doesn't check their records, He just lets them go. I want another story before I let you go. Soon after 9/11 in America, there was a lot of security at the airports. And of course, they gave Muslims special treatment when they travel. Right, so we had take your shoes off and go through extra security and pat downs and all of it. It's not like that anymore. The first couple of years were pretty bad. So one time I was traveling and nobody gave me extra security. I traveled like a regular person. I went through the metal detector and they did not say, sir, step on the side, let's give you an extra special treatment because you're a Muslim. Nothing. So I was surprised. I looked at the security guard and I said, you know, I don't get it. But immediately the ayah came in my mind, حِسَابًا يَسِيرًا. Allah Azza wa Jalla describes on judgment day, there will be people who will have their book in their right hand. فَسَوْفَ يُحَاسَبُ حِسَابًا يَسِيرًا فَأَمَّا مَنْ أُوتِيَ كِتَابَهُ بِيَمِينِهِ فَسَوْفَ يُحَاسَبُ حِسَابًا يَسِيرًا. The guy who gets the book handed to him in his right hand, he will be given an easy audit. You don't have to open your book and show the angels. By the way, on page 35 I have a hajj. Please make sure you check that one. You know, I think I called Laylatul Qadr this Ramadan, if you make sure I get that. The angel says, gali koi nahi, jao, just go, it's okay, no big deal. They're not checked. But if you get stopped by security on judgment day, and they say, let's see your book, and they open the page, and you even get asked one question, judgment day is bad for you. It's bad for you. إِنَّهُ مَنْ سُئِلَ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ فَقَدْ هَلَكَ. The one who gets asked even one question on judgment day is done, is destroyed. On judgment day, either we will be people under the shade of Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, or we will be people under the justice of Maliki Yawmiddin. We want Allah Azza wa Jal not to judge us. We want Him to show us His mercy, so we don't take advantage of it. We keep it balanced. This is the essence of who Allah Azza wa Jal is to us. Don't think that you're forgiven just because you do some good deeds. Don't think like that. And don't think Allah will not forgive you. If you've made mistakes all of your life, and you made mistakes even before you came to Salah today, if you did that, don't think that you're going to hell. You're not. Who says you're going to hell? You're still alive. The opportunity for tawbah is still there. Allah is still letting air into your lungs. He's still letting you breathe, which means He still wants you to come to Him. If He wanted you to be done, you wouldn't be alive right now. Everybody who's alive is because Allah wants them to make tawbah. That's a mercy of Allah to them. So you don't ever think it's too late for me, or I've done too many bad things. Allah will not forgive me. You're not bigger than the mercy of Allah. You're not bigger than the forgiveness of Allah. And at the same time, don't you ever think, and I should never think, that I will only do a few bad things, it's no big deal though. I read a lot of Quran, I'm okay. I make salat in the masjid, I'm okay. I have some bad habits, they're hard to let go of. But it's okay, Allah will forgive those. Nuh-uh. There are some people who only have one sin, and they keep doing it over and over again. It's one problem they have, and they don't let it go. Allah Azza wa Jalla describes this in the Quran. بَلَا مَنْ كَسَبَ سَيِّئَةً وَأَحَاطَتْ بِهِ خَطِيئَتُهُ فَأُولَٰئِكَ أَصْحَابُ النَّارِ. The guy who earned one sin, he's obsessed with one problem. He's got one addiction. It could be alcohol, it could be drugs, it could be pornography. I don't know, it could be something for you. It could be your anger, it could be abusive language, it could be backbiting. I don't know what your problem is. We all have some problem. But you don't let go of it. You hold on to that sin and you say, it's just one problem. Everything else is good though. You accept it. Then Allah says you get wrapped up into that sin. And those are people of fire. Those are people of fire. They don't let go of their sin. May Allah Azza wa Jal help us accept the fact that we are slaves of His. And may Allah Azza wa Jal help us earn His mercy and His love in this dunya and in the akhirah. May Allah Azza wa Jal truly make us a people of gratitude, of alhamdulillah, that we, instead of complaining, become a people that are constantly optimistic. And I pray, as I leave you, I just want to share with you, inshaAllah ta'ala, especially the young people in the audience. You don't have something called free time, guys. You don't. You are members of this ummah. Any member of this ummah, especially the young member of this ummah, is constantly working to make his society better, to do something good for people. You don't have free time. You don't have time to play video games for 8 hours. You don't have time for Grand Theft Auto. You don't have time for Modern Warfare. You don't have time. You don't have time for the new movie that's coming out. You don't have time for Superman. You don't have time. You have time to do more important things. That your youth of this ummah, hold yourself to a higher standard. Not just because the elders are telling you, because the sheikh is telling you, because somebody else is telling you. Because your own conscience should tell you. Your la ilaha illallah should tell you, man. It should tell you that you have to be active people. That you will see corruption around you in society. You'll see youth that are getting away from Allah. Who do you think will invite them? Me? No, they don't. Those kids that don't come to the masjid. Those kids that don't come to any halaqat. I have no way of reaching them. You have to reach them. You know, they're your friends. They hang out with you, not with me. You gotta go to them. You have to be their du'at. You have to be an inspiration to them. So you have to make sure that you become a person of concern for those around you, your friends. Don't just complain about your friends. Man, my friends, all they do is watch movies, this and that. Have you ever advised them? Have you ever given them something more positive to do instead? Have you been a good influence for them? You know? This is what you have to do. May Allah Azza wa Jal make our youth the leaders of this ummah. And may Allah Azza wa Jal make them role models for others who have gone away from Allah to bring them closer to Allah Azza wa Jal. May Allah make all of you examples, good examples of Islam. So the non-Muslims who come to this country, they just see you and they say, man, I want to be Muslim. I want to be like that guy. I want you to be like that. That's the character you live by. Your honesty, your integrity, the way you carry yourself, the respect you show to others. You know, they just see that and they say, man, I want to be a Muslim. These Muslims have something special. This is what you have to become. Don't think you're going to give da'wah to non-Muslims by handing them a pamphlet or giving them a website or showing them a video. The real da'wah to Islam is the character of a Muslim. It's the character of a Muslim. You are the du'at of Islam without even opening your mouth. Especially here, when you have guests coming, when you have non-Muslims coming, and they're observing the Muslims. And they don't think that it's Muslims. They're not going to say, Islam is great, but the Muslims are messed up. They're not going to think like that. They're going to think Islam is messed up. Because whatever they see you doing, they think that's Islam. So whatever you're doing, no matter when you're doing it,
you are ambassadors of Islam. Allah will ask you and me on Judgment Day, this is what you showed to those who were coming to Islam? Were you the reason they came close to Islam, or were you the reason they went even further away from Islam? SubhanAllah. The responsibility that rests on our shoulders. May Allah Azza wa Jal give us the ability to carry that responsibility and become responsible members of this beautiful ummah. Alhamdulillah wa kafa wa salatu wa salam ala ibadihi alladhina astafa khususan ala afdalihim wa khatamin nabiyyin Muhammadin al-Amin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Yaqulu Allah Azza wa Jal fi kitabihi al-Kareem ba'da naqula a'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. Inna Allah wa malaikatahu yusalluna ala al-Nabi. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد عباد الله رحمكم الله اتقوا الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون. Mm-hmm.